Testing, 1, 2, 3. So we have quorum in the room. If committee members could take the chairs, please. So before we launch into the formal agenda of the meeting, I'd just like to take an opportunity to thank our snow removal crews that were out again hard at work last night. The first half of this winter was great. The second half is proving to be quite a challenge in terms of the intensity, volume, and regularity of these storms. We got a little bit lucky last night in the sense that we didn't get as much snow as we anticipated. We got about 12 centimeters overnight as of about 6:30 this morning. It's still falling out there. Staff have been out since the beginning and will continue to do a residential plow run. A residential plow run started at 7 o'clock this morning and will continue until we've got all the residential streets done. But again, I want to thank staff. As I say, it has been a challenging second half to this winter, and I think that they've risen to the challenge. And I would send the same positive comments out to OC as well. Not my committee, but I still think that they've done an excellent job in getting people across the city in very difficult weather circumstances, whether it be freezing rain or snow or drizzle or all three sometimes or four in the same event. So I just wanted to acknowledge that and thank staff for the work that they're doing. It's much appreciated. So now we'll go through the agenda. First of all, we have regrets. Councillor Moffat is unable to attend this morning, but I should point out it has nothing to do with the weather. He gave notice of that a couple of days ago. There are no declarations of interest. Confirmation of minutes for the 3rd of February 2016. Confirmed? Thank you. The response to inquiries as set out in the agenda. The first item is the municipal green fleet plan, and I understand that Councillor Fleury intends to introduce a motion, so we'll hold that, and hopefully he'll be here by the time we get back to it. The number two is the fleet parts program improvement, and there'll be a short presentation by Kevin Wiley, so we're going to hold that as well. Thirdly is the Bradley Estates Community Association Renault Road proposal, staff review, and we have a delegation on that, so we'll hold that as well. Number four is the temporary outdoor patio encroachment at 200 Elgin Street. We have no delegations on this. Can we carry this item? Okay, thank you. Number five is the Ottawa Road 174 Prescott Russell 17 Trim Road to Canaan Road environmental assessment study, and we do have a public delegation on that, so we'll hold that item as well. And there's also a technical amendment that will be moved by Councillor McKinney. Moving into the councillor's items, I have an item which is the waiver of the encroachment bylaw and relief from the use of care of roads to bylaw to permit the installation of two book sharing structures. To boil that down, there are some people in my community that want to create sharing libraries in the neighborhood by setting up little enclosures to pick up and drop off books, and in order to do that, they need a waiver of the bylaw to be on the city right of way, even though it's actually going to be on their lawns in effect, but on our part of their lawns. So, if there's no objection, can we carry that? Okay, thank you,
Mr. Chair. Is it possible to give a direction to staff so that it's facilitated process for the next time for if community groups come ahead?
Well, it's facilitated in the sense, Councillor, that I did speak to staff, and unfortunately it has to be on a case-by-case basis depending on what the location is. But I can tell you from working with staff on this, it's a very simple matter to go ahead with.
Thank you.
Next is a matter for Councillor McKinney, Business Improvement Area Anti-Graffiti Grant Program. Perhaps we'll hold that one because I know she's in the building, but she's not here yet. So we'll hold that one perhaps in case she wishes to speak to it. And I note that we also have a delegation in the room, but who I believe, Ms. Ledman, you're in favor of the motion. So we'll just wait, and if you don't mind, and I'll just, as soon as the vice chair gets here, we'll deal with it. Okay. So we'll go to the first item, which is municipal green fleet plan. We're asking that be approved this morning, but I believe Councillor Fleury has a motion that he wishes to introduce this morning.
Oui, merci, Monsieur le Président. So I've worked with staff on this motion. We've recognized the efforts of Public Works and the fleet group to bring in vehicles in the fleet that are greener, that are similar in price range. And what we've noticed is that, in this case, it says client service. So when the fleet group goes out and works with the different departments, the departments come up with their priorities and the vehicles and work with the fleet staff, but there's nothing mandating staff to use or to purchase equal or fair value vehicles that are friendlier to the environment. Obviously, on the green on the fleet side, they push it, but it's not mandated. So, as part of this motion, we'd mandate that it's all in line with our climate change plan. It's in line also with our purchasing strategies at the city. So, it's really making sure that as part of this, and I'll read the therefore be it resolved so that everyone's clear. Therefore, be it resolved that Transportation Committee recommend that City Council approve the Green Fleet Plan on the understanding that the Public Works Department will purchase hybrid and electric vehicles in 2017-2018. As an aside, because there's been a push in 2016 on the budget front on behalf of their clients when hybrid and electric options exist in the market, where those vehicles meet operational needs and where there is available funding to purchase them. And therefore, be resolved that all departments that use municipal fleet services, I think OC Transpo and police are the only two that don't, be required to indicate when green fleet vehicles or technology will not be purchased as part of the annual report to on fleet purchases for life cycles and growth vehicles prior to the consideration of each annual budget.
Okay, thank you. Are there any questions for staff? I have a couple. So my concern about this motion is this, Mr. Wiley, maybe you can allay that concern. So you look at your operational needs and you need four new snowplows, for example, four Zambonis, whatever the vehicle is. You look at your budget and you have the money to buy four, let's use the term regular, conventional vehicles, or you have the money to buy two hybrids or electrical or whatever. How is this motion going to impact on you and still be able to meet operational needs?
Chair, the way the Green Fleet Fund works is that it's a pot of money, $500,000, and it's only used to top up the additional cost for a green piece of equipment. So if a hybrid, for example, costs $10,000 or $7,000 more than a regular car, we would just take the incremental cost from the Green Fleet Fund, so it wouldn't impact our replacement plan going forward.
Well, until you run out of the $500,000. That's what I'm trying to find out. I'm trying to find out from staff, if you exhaust your green fund, what's the impact of this motion on purchases going forward? Does it mean you have to take your regular fleet replacement money and spend it on green, which is not necessarily a bad thing, unless it impacts on your ability to meet operational requirements? So I'm trying to figure out what happens when that fund is exhausted and this motion is in force. Does that mean you have to buy less vehicles when you actually need more vehicles?
Chair, the spirit of the Green Fleet Fund, and I think the spirit of the motion would be that we would buy up to the point of the fund of the Green Fleet Fund, and after that, any other vehicles would be purchased as per regular. The reality is, across the wide range of equipment we buy, there are only certain ones that are suitable, or are there that there's technology existing for hybrid, electric, etc. So there's a large number of vehicles that aren't even eligible to be purchased in a green fashion.
So do you anticipate that this motion is going to actually induce you to buy more green? Or is it more of a symbolic thing?
I think what the motion does, Chair, is that it does make us more aggressive towards buying more green as the cost of hybrids, for instance, comes down and starts to meet the cost of regular vehicles. We should be purchasing more. But in addition, I think the other thing it does is makes the Green Fleet Plan transparent for Council. So each year they'll look at the report, our replacement report. They'll see what we've purchased green, what we can't purchase green, and then with some commentary from the departments about why there's some operational issues that they can't purchase green.
So you're confident that it's not going to impact on your ability to deliver the services?
Correct, Chair.
Okay, thank you. Councillor Kakish. Okay, Councillor Blay.
Thanks very much. So I appreciate that the intent and the spirit of the motion is as you described. I always get caught in the conundrum, though. It's great while you're here, and it's great while maybe 10 of the people in this room continue to be here. But what happens, you get hit by a bus tomorrow, and your replacement interprets the motion in a different way. So is there a way to finesse it in such a way that it doesn't lead to the outcomes that Councillor Eglad was talking about?
Perhaps I'll ask the clerk to comment on that. I think the motion would remain the motion as we go forward in time.
It's clear that the motion itself has a phrase at the end of the first, therefore be it resolved, where there is available funding to purchase them. So as the GM mentioned.
Can we add from the Green Fleet Fund or something to that effect as a friendly amendment so that we're not dipping into other sources to upset the apple cart, so to speak?
Yeah, that would be recommended.
Yeah, I would agree with that because when I read through the motion again after you answered the questions, we don't talk about, we talk about the Green Fleet Plan, but we never reference the Green Fleet Fund. So if Councillor Fleury is okay with that as essentially a friendly amendment, if the court could amend the motion. Is that okay, Councillor Fleury?
Yes.
Okay. Sorry, Councillor
Fleury. I have a couple other questions. When assessing the options for purchasing green vehicles, you know, for motor vehicles, it's probably very easy. There's lots of industry standards and the consumer acceptance and et cetera. But for non-traditional vehicles, what's the evaluation process for their efficacy and efficiency in delivering what they need to do? You know, we had obviously a very unfortunate situation at OC Transfer where certain green vehicles did not meet the standards on the financial recovery side that were expected. And so what processes are gone through to evaluate, you know, a Zamboni or a snowplow or, you know, non-traditional vehicles?
We have a rigorous, Chair, we have a rigorous specification that we put forth. That's a collaborative one. We work with the department, we work with the vendors to make sure that the vehicle will do what it's supposed to do.
But do you test it in real situations? Do you send it to the NRC for testing? Like how do you, you know, I'm selling you something, I tell you that it'll do the job, great, but, you know, how do you know as the purchaser that it will do the job?
Yeah, Chair, we do testing and we do evaluations.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
The amended motion is on the screen if anybody wants to have a quick look at it. Councillor Kakish.
I guess I just want clarification also on, you know, the OC Transpo experience and the actual real savings and efficiencies when we are investing in the hybrid models too. And I don't understand the motion seems redundant to me, because I think we've already give this direction in the plan that we have for the green fleet. So am I wrong in that assumption?
Chair, I think, again, as not to repeat myself, but what the motion does in my mind is makes it much more transparent. So for instance, if we go to a client group and offer a green option and they give us an operational reason that they can't go with a green option, that's going to be something that councillors will see and we'll be able to challenge the department heads on.
Okay, thanks.
Are there any other Councillor Chernyshenko?
Thank you. I do see the value in bumping this up, if you will, in terms of its transparency and suppose the clarity that we will always look at these options, won't necessarily choose them, but we'll look at them and we'll report as to why we did or didn't choose them. I'm certainly an advocate of only making these kinds of purchases when there is either a no net loss in terms of cost or a financial savings over the long term. I know initially there's going to be an upfront cost, but we get the payback over fuel savings or comparison between electrical costs versus fuel costs, or I know in the case of the electric Zambonis, other values that we get, the indoor air quality in arenas and the lack of the non-risk of carbon monoxide poisoning incidents in arenas, which is actually something that's sadly quite frequent in arenas as a result of those. So I guess what I'm trying to say is only in rare circumstances should we be purchasing symbolically, for example. We might want the mayor in the latest electric vehicle the next time he replaces it for that symbolic value, but on the whole that the city is making these purchases because they make financial or some other performance sense, is that still what we would be getting with this?
And Chair, that's correct, and I think a good example of that is the trial we had with our electric vehicle. It was good in theory, but both the amount of miles that we were required the inspectors to put on, plus the harsh winters we found when we did the testing, I believe a year ago, technology isn't quite there yet for municipal fleet use. You know, obviously for private use it's there, but for municipal fleet use it may not be there yet.
Mm-hmm. And to pick up then on Councillor Blais' point, and I think a number of others' sentiment as well, is that we did have an unfortunate experience with the hybrid buses. I think we can all nod and agree that, given that the real use, the runs that OC Transpo does and where the hybrid buses were supposed to have offered a benefit didn't end up matching very well with the distances and the highway driving and that sort of thing. So I would just encourage the department to be more skeptical of the vendor's claims and use as often as possible the real performance in other cities where these types of vehicles have been used, so that we were not caught wishing that they had delivered the savings that we were promised. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor. Are there any other questions?
No.
Sure.
So just a quick wrap-up. I appreciate and I think the comments and questions from my colleagues are very helpful to clarify the motion. A couple of key points. So the friendly amendment to the first, therefore be it resolved, I just want to clarify with you, Kevin, that under existing condition at equal price, so just for sake of discussion, if we were to buy a Honda Civic and a Honda Civic Hybrid is the same price, that amount of money would not come from the green plan. It would come from regular fleet spendings. Is that correct?
Correct, Chair. That would come from the replacement program and would not touch the green fleet plan.
Okay. And I just want to highlight two little segments. So on the Zamboni front, I think that the derivatives of costs are important to know as well. So a non-electric Zamboni requires us to do many dampers and many systems filter in the arenas that are actually very expensive to do. When you look at just the cost of the Zamboni, it's a disincentive to go to the electric Zamboni. But when you look at the overall cost of the operation of the arena, my understanding is that there might be a significant reduction in price. So I'm just saying that out there because I think it's important to recognize that it's not simply the vehicle or there's derivatives and there's benefits elsewhere that are also need to be financially accounted for. And finally, I think that we should be careful around low gas prices, because 2016 low gas prices, when we buy a car or a vehicle for 5 years, when you look at you need to look at 5-year trends in the gas sector to actually establish a fair rating, because or else we're not going to be able to achieve any of those savings, and really it's going to cost us a lot more in the end. We know that gas prices are bound to go up. We have seen a reduction, but overall I think the investments, and as highlighted by Kevin, that hybrid vehicles have become a lot more competitive in prices. And I recognize that in our fleet services, we have vehicles that do very heavy duty work, and that's different. But for example, bylaw cars should all be very fuel efficient. They're always on the road. They always stop start. So there's similarities there. So I'm really speaking, and this motion really targets the vehicular fleet that we have, but we expand it across the entire review. So I want to thank my colleagues for the information provided.
So on the motion as amended.
Carried.
Okay, thank you. And on the report?
I have
on which? The motion or the? On the report. Okay. Councillor Drews?
Thank you, Chair. I have a few questions on the report. It says that we are going through a pilot project for our fleet. And it speaks on it on the last. There will be spending $20,000 to have a pilot project on. For readers and for 2 city fuel tanks and 25 car.
Sorry, Chair, could the council repeat the question?
Yeah, it says on the report that we're doing trial will cost approximately $20,000, which include $10,000 for 2 readers on the gas tanks and $10,000 for 10 car, 25 devices will be installed. It's at the last paragraph.
It's the telematics. Chair, that's for telematics. So the plan, we're going to pilot this year telematics, and if successful, the telematic technology will be placed in approximately 500 vehicles in 2017.
So that's the time frame for that pilot project?
That's correct, Chair.
Thanks. And my other question will be on, we did a pilot on a paramedic and we installed some equipment that will, it doesn't necessarily right now, we can run the, to help decrease the idling time. Could you give us quick how this is going and the time frame of implementing the whole project on that matter?
So we've done 2 things with the paramedics. The one is put in additional heating systems that are separate from the actual vehicle, so you don't draw the battery. That was a first pass, and all that ambulance has been equipped with that now. The second phase, and what we're referring to there, is a full comprehensive anti-idling system that would ensure you could run everything on the ambulance without having the vehicle turned over at all, so the engine totally stopped. And that pilot, the pilot's done. We believe we've already picked now the proper vendor, so we'll be able to implement this over the course of the next year or so.
Thank you, and it shows that we do have the budget and we have the money to finish and complete this project?
Correct.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Thank you.
Any other questions on the main report? Carried. Okay, thank you. I think we'll jump ahead to number 7 on the agenda. because the vice chair is now in the room, and she's indicated she's got no concerns about the item. And Ms. Ledman, I understand that, is Ms. Ledman still here? Yep, there you are. As much as we enjoy your company, I understand that if this is going to pass, that you don't need to present. Does anybody have any concerns about this item? You okay? They want to hear from you, Christine, so come on down.
No, just joking.
They're just playing with you. Okay, so if there are no concerns, Carrie? Okay, thank you. Thank you, Christine. That then brings us to number two on the list, which is the fleet parts and program improvements. And Kevin Wiley's got a brief presentation on that.
Did you pass number four?
Thank you, Chair. And I neglected to introduce Don Donnell, who is the manager of Fleet Services, earlier. So Don's sitting to my right. As you stated, we do have a short presentation. Just by way of background, in 2011, United Parts Auto Parts Incorporated, or otherwise known as NAPA, purchased the city's fleet inventory as part of the Transform Fleet Initiative for about $4.5 million. And this was only part of the Transform Fleet Initiative. It also included right-sizing the fleet, the procurement of fleet, reducing fuel costs, maintenance costs, and as well parts inventory, which the NAPA contract was part of. This was a five-year contract to manage the inventory and ordering for fleet. And two features of the contract, and this is something councillors may recall from the Auditor General's report on the contract, that in addition to purchasing fleet parts, NAPA had a provision for an $850,000 administration fee for the contract, and in addition, a 10% markup on the cost of the parts. Anticipated benefits of the contracting out of the parts program were better parts pricing, because we were going from, previous to the NAPA contract, the city was dealing with some 300 or more individual vendors. So we thought by going to one vendor, we would definitely get better pricing. Also, improved delivery timelines was an anticipated benefit, having the right part at the right time. And also decreasing, even though we were paying an administration fee to NAPA, decreasing the administrative costs because we found an efficiency of 12 FTs at the time from the fleet parts area.
Can you do them both?
So as I mentioned, in March 2015, the Auditor General tabled a report on audit of specific contracts and processes in the Fleet Services Branch. The NAPA contract was part of that audit, and the Auditor General pointed out some issues with the contract, primarily along the lines of performance and timelines. One of the big issues with the contract was that, or the model I should say, that didn't work so well was that the NAPA inventory system could not be reconciled with the city's inventory system. And this was an issue because it continually resulted in wrong parts being delivered to our mechanics, and that resulted in delay of repairing our vehicles. And of course, we need the vehicles on the road for days like today when we're out there plowing. He also found that the inventory stock was not being managed proactively, and what that means is that there was a lot of old stock being kept and not utilized. And also that the delivery, the picking of the stock picking of the parts was extremely slow. So the AG's recommendation at that time was that the city engage a third-party expert to undertake a benchmark review of the parts and services provided by NAPA to ensure that the city was receiving fair marketing, best customer pricing. In 2015, Fleet Services contracted Bronson Consulting, and they conducted the review. The findings of the review were that they compared prices the city paid to NAPA versus the standard industry prices, and they did find that we are receiving very fair pricing from NAPA. However, they also mentioned that the markup could be avoided if we went directly to the vendors. So as a result of that, the city issued a request for information to look at different fleet part supply models, and we contacted and we went directly to the vendors. As I said, the RFI looked at various service models available. Our primary interest was to remain was that the parts inventory remain with the vendors so that we could avoid the repurchasing of the parts. However, the results of the RFI showed, or the study showed, that no single vendor had the ability to undertake the full program because we have such a large variety of fleet vehicles and equipment. Nobody has the expertise to manage all those parts. Also, no single respondent supported the existing service model without some sort of variation. And the majority of the parts vendors that we contacted had no interest in holding the city's inventory. So based on the AG's findings, review done by Bronson Consulting, and issues experienced with the current service delivery model, the department's not recommending an extension to the existing contract because we don't think it's sustainable going forward, and we also don't think it's in the best interests of the city. We are, at the end of the contract, obligated to buy back the inventory. The contract ends in July, so we're obligated to buy back the inventory at the level that we sold it to NAPA at. The RFI confirmed an in-house management with the procurement aligned to market segments, not going back to the 300 vendors, but to choose a discrete number of market segments would be the best model going forward. We do have the expertise to manage the parts, and this is common practice in most municipalities that we benchmarked against. The model would not result in any operating budget pressures. In fact, we are anticipating savings primarily because, as the Bronson review indicated, we can avoid the 10% markup right away by going directly to the vendor segments. We won't know, however, what the savings of that would be until we get our tenders out on the road and out on the street, and we get the tender results back. And also, inventory tracking will be much more reliable because we won't have one system talking to the other system. We'll be using one system. I want to emphasize that this isn't a return to the old system that saw 12 FTs responsible for the program. We are anticipating doing the new system with 5 FTs. We won't need new FTs. We're going to be doing it within our current allotment. And the lesser FTs are required because, as I said, we're not going back to the 300 vendor contacts. We anticipate with the new system just using dealing with 4 vendors in 4 discrete segments, and those segments are light fleet parts, heavy fleet parts, bulk fluids, and potentially specialty items. But by leaving it just with 4, we think that we'll be able to do it with a lot less staff. I wanted to mention a few additional steps. As councillors are aware, we have paused for 2016 on a replacement plan while we do our fleet operational review. This means that we have even greater need to make sure that we get parts in a timely fashion because the vehicles have to stay on the road. As we're not replacing them, they're getting a little older. It's important that our staff continue working through as they need to. We think there will be more efficiencies in the fleet service review. Ernst & Young has been retained and is in the middle of doing that review now. Some of the things they'll be looking at are our staffing levels, our current service model, and our most importantly, our investment levels in our new fleet. And again, as I said, efficiencies may be realized in addition. That review will be probably complete in May 2016, and we'll be presenting that to the Transportation Committee at that time. And that ends the presentation. We'd be happy to take any questions.
Okay, thank you very much. I'm going to start off. You've indicated the purchase back price is 4.5, and you're recommending that comes out of the reserve. If we make that recommendation to council, how much is going to be left in your reserve?
Chair, there'll be about $5 million left in the reserve.
Okay. And do you anticipate, in addition to the $4.5 million expenditure, that there will be any, for lack of a better term, break-in costs? In other words, is there going to be a cost to implementing the new system over and above the $4.5 million?
Chair, we anticipate there's going to be a cost of about $130,000 for a vehicle and a few other items.
So $130,000 for what?
For a vehicle and a few. Correct. For a vehicle and the price to audit the new system.
This is going to be a green vehicle?
We'll do our best, Chair.
So the but the 130 you anticipate, even after that expenditure, you anticipate this approach is still going to create additional savings to the city, correct?
Correct. We're confident we'll achieve savings because we're working with the $800,000 admin fee plus the 10% markup on parts. But as I said before, until we get those actual tenders in, we're confident they'll come in at about the same level that we're paying NAPA as per the review that we did. But until you get those tender prices in, you won't know.
When you say comparable without the additional 10% bump up, is that that's what you're saying?
Correct.
Okay. Thank you. I think Councillor Deans had some questions.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Well, Mr. Riley, this is really adding up for me, so I'm just going to need a little further explanation than I can glean from this report. So before NAPA took over, we had 12 people managing our fleet's part program.
That's correct, Chair.
Okay, and then we decided it would be more cost-effective for us to farm it out to NAPA, so we did that. And NAPA recently came back and said that the $850,000 administrative fee that we are paying them to administer wasn't enough, so they needed more to do it.
That's correct.
So now we're going to take it back, but we're saying instead of the 12 people that it used to take to run it, now it'll only take 5. How does that work? How are we going to administer a program with just 5 when NAPA couldn't do it with 5 and we didn't do it previously with 5?
Chair, the problem again is when we were doing it previously that we were dealing with over 300 vendors, and that administrative reconciliation is, as you can imagine, very, very time consuming. I will admit that prior to NAPA taking over, we weren't running the most effective and efficient program. We do feel confident that we can go forward with 5 staff.
So what's that based on? Like, is there no systems in place? Is it, have we used an IT system upgrade? Like, how do we just have that many less staff? I understand you're going to try and use less vendors, but it's still a major fleet. It's a huge fleet. It's lots of geography. There's, like, how do you get to 5 people?
We will be using our system, which is M5, and that's a system that the mechanics use to order the parts. That's a system that we inventory the parts for, and that's a system that they'll be put in as they're brought to the door. So we think we'll have a huge efficiency there. Mr. Donnell would like to say a few words too.
Where did those 5 come from, since we're not adding any FTEs?
Councillor Deans, I believe they're not quite finished answering the last question.
Sorry.
I just wanted to make the point that we actually have staff who remained behind after the last streamlining took place when NAPA was outsourced. So we still have all our expertise in-house. So we're supplementing the group we already do have. So it's not just 5 taking this over. They're joining the group that already exists that we're supporting the NAPA contract from the city side.
So we kept our staff? What were they doing?
There was a number of staff who were involved in management of the parts to begin with on the motive side. 12 of them left when NAPA took over their portion of the contract.
Well, that's fascinating. So we paid NAPA $850,000 to administer, but we kept our own staff?
Yes, because we do have to reconcile the work they do. We did have to verify that when we have to get involved in inventory counts to make sure that we knew exactly what we were paying for.
Okay, well, that doesn't sound terribly efficient, I have to admit. So I want to talk about the health of this reserve since we're taking another $4.5 million. So you said something, Mr. Wadley, that kind of concerned me. You said that Napa had a lot of old stock that was being kept and not utilized. So is the $4.5 million that we're buying back the old stock that is out of date and we won't be able to use?
No, we will be doing a reconciliation with them. We've already started that process, and we'll be going through that inventory and making sure we draw down everything we can. But we have told them that we will only be purchasing the stock that we require, and it'll be at the same level.
So what's the agreement that forces us to pay the $4.5 million?
It's the contract with NAPA.
So does it give us the right to pick and choose what we take, what we buy back, or do we have to take it lock, stock, and barrel?
It's broken into components. So some of the older stuff they were responsible for using during the course of the contract. If they didn't use it, if we originally acquired it, we own that portion of it. If we did not use it all when they bought it off of us. But new things they brought in, we do not have to hold on to, so they would take that away if we don't need it.
So are you confident that everything we're buying back are parts that we can still use that aren't outdated or obsolete?
Absolutely. We've been working on this for a year and a half as we prepared for the switchover.
Okay. And then I just want to talk about the reserves. So you said there's, Mr. Wiley, you said there's about $5 million left in the fleet reserve. What is our normal balance in the fleet? I know we shored up our operating budget this year using fleet, $23 million.
So no, the balance of the fleet reserve does fluctuate. So it could be, it can get lower or a little bit higher, but the amount we use for the replacement of the vehicles every year is aside from that. So if we were starting 2016 on a normal year, they would have deposited into our reserve an additional, in this year would have been about $23 million. So we would have had the 23 plus the 5 sitting there. We would have spent the 23. The other 5 is in reserve because sometimes we have an unexpected fire that takes place, like we had at one of our sites that destroyed 3 vehicles, so then we'll reach into the upper piece.
Okay. So.
Sorry, if I can just clarify that. It's the reserve we're talking about. It's a little confusing, I understand. But it's almost like a floating reserve. As you tender vehicles, you get them at a lower price. Then you have more money that floats from year to year to year. So we do anticipate after we do our operational review that the consultant will come back and council accept a level of investment in our fleet that will remain constant. But what we're talking about here is over and above that.
Okay, so this year we didn't make the $23 million contribution that we would normally make to this reserve because we had other things to spend that money on. So there was $10 million in the reserve, and we're going to use about half of that to buy back these parts?
Yes.
And are we confident that $5 million is enough for the rest of the year in that reserve?
Absolutely.
Okay. Those are all my questions. Thank you.
Thank you. Councillor McKinney.
Thank you, Chair. I had many of the same questions, of course. So just to start, the whole NAPA program, the outsourcing to NAPA, was that not part of the 2010 to 2014 efficiency program?
That's correct.
And what was that target, that efficiency target?
12 FTEs, and I believe
4.5. Total was 3.5.
And $3.9 million was taken out of the fleet budget.
So it didn't work. Is that what we're saying? Obviously we're doing more with less, which I'll get to a little later, but in terms of FTEs. But did we realize the $3.9 million in savings and efficiencies, rather? Not savings.
Chair, yes, we did, and if I can maybe categorize it a different way, the NAPA contract was only part of the whole fleet transformation. And like I said in the presentation, at the time, it kind of triggered other efficiencies that we were able to gain. But looking back, we think we can do better, and that's what this report is about. We think we can do better with the fleet parts and achieve over and above the 3.9 that we already achieved.
So I guess what I'm looking at, I mean, you know, we're only going back, say, 5 years to when we brought in this program. I know that you established earlier that, you know, we weren't doing what we could have been doing prior to 2010, which is, you know, a bit concerning. But I just go back to it. It almost sounds like the snow clearing issue where, you know, we're going to cut money, we're going to cut FTEs in this case, and we're going to just do everything that we were doing, but do it better. And I guess that begs the question, you know, are we always looking, like, every day at ways of finding efficiencies, of doing things better? Because it seems to me that, you know, we entered into this contract, spent a lot of money, and now we're de-investing ourselves, if you will. And I just, you know, when I think about going from 12 FTEs to 5, 12 that used to do this work, to 5, plus the contract with NAPA, and now we're going to find those FTEs internally. I just want to pick up on what Councillor Deans was asking. How exactly, like, I understand we're going from 300 to 4 vendors, but there must be, are we investing in a new technology? Like, what are we doing to be able to, so that I have some confidence when I leave here today that we're actually going to be able to do the same work with virtually no staff that we had prior to 2010, and do it with, you know, do it on, looking at 4 vendors. How is that going to work?
Well, I'll let staff jump in, but I think it was clarified that it's not just 5. It's 5 plus some additional staff that were already in place. So it's not 5. Maybe you can reiterate that and then move on to the balance of the answer.
You're correct, Chair. And I think to answer the councillor, it also speaks to the operational efficiency reviews that we're undertaking right now. It's not doing the same thing better. It's doing something different, and that's what we're doing here. We're doing something different. We're not dealing with 300 vendors and the administrative nightmare that presents. We're dealing with 4 vendors in 4 distinct streams, 4 vendors that are very well versed and very capable of managing the parts and the fluids that they're obligated to manage. To look back to the NAP, I've already said at the time we thought it was the right model to go with. We think we can make it better. And even with NAPA, although they're a large company, even they couldn't deal with all the myriad of parts and other things that we have to purchase to keep our fleet going. So I think we're improving the situation, and we're not doing the same thing better, we're making it different.
And do you have a list of who those 4 vendors are?
Chair, we haven't gone out to contract yet. We have been in discussions with them, but we won't be able to go out to tender until this goes through council.
And is it possible that NAPA would be one of those vendors?
Chair, NAPA is certainly welcome to bid on a contract.
Okay, thank you.
Councillor Cawdrey, please.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chair. Excuse me. Just coming back to a couple of questions in terms of operations, this new system that you're setting up with dealing with 4 vendors, are the vendors capable of providing all of our needs in terms of parts, the 4 themselves, or is it a system similar to NAPA where they gather the parts from other vendors and then service the industry?
Chair, they will be capable of delivering on those 4 streams of parts. I should have mentioned at the outset the big difference in the model is that Currently, NAPA manages the city stores in the city building, so the parts come into them, and there's exchange at the counter. And that's where we're having trouble with the languages talking, the two systems talking together, and also the timely delivery of parts. In the new model, the four vendors will deliver to our dock the parts that we order, and then our staff will take over and put them in the system and then deliver them to the mechanics. So I think that's a much more effective way of doing it. You're not dealing with multiple handoffs. You're just dealing with one handoff at the loading dock.
Any idea what the cost is for these four vendors? Similar, is it similar to NAPA what they were charging? Is it less? How much does that cost for those four vendors?
Again, we won't know until we go to tender, but from what the Bronson Consulting Report found was that we can achieve in the market in a competitive process similar, if not better, pricing than NAPA was giving us, less, of course, the 10% markup that NAPA put on parts.
In terms of storage of these parts in our own facilities, I would assume, do we have to set up something different or something different than what we're doing today? Or will the four vendors maintain the inventory and just deliver to us?
No, they just deliver it to our dock. We take it from there, and we have all the setup currently, so it's all ready to go.
In terms of, I remember back in 2010, the reason why we went to the current model, sort of, was the fact that we were having difficulty managing number of units or number of parts that we were dealing with. Every time there was a change in technology in a service vehicle, we had to get rid of the old inventory that we were no longer using and bring in new inventory. Can you see that similar problem with this model?
And Chair, I think with any inventory system, you are going to have some obsolete parts at some point that you'll have to write off. I think that's just a reality of the system.
Have we put a cost to carrying these SKUs in the system as to how much of it percentage-wise would be obsolete? I mean, we should know that from our previous experience.
Chair, I think when we do the handoff with NAPA, that, and you know, we're in the middle of those negotiations now, clearly we're going to limit any liability we would have from that front.
Okay, but that's from NAPA today. That, you know, you may work on a new contract with them. I'm talking about when we set up our own system and the SKUs that we're listing, let's say we're listing 300 different items, and all of a sudden, as we heard this morning on the previous item, where we're demanding change in terms of a better vehicle or more efficient vehicle, that obviously would put pressure on the system that you're working with. Any idea what the, you know, what percentage of that system would be obsolete in terms of number of SKUs?
Chair, I think we would manage the inventory properly, keep the inventory levels low, just-in-time delivery, those sorts of things would help minimize any liability we would have from there.
Thank you for that, Mr. Riley. How much of our current servicing is provided by outside vendors, private vendors? For example, if there's a breakdown in a bus or breakdown in a vehicle, do we send it out for service or do we service all of it in-house?
I don't know the percentage off the top of my head. We would do the majority of it. And we're actually looking at that as part of our fleet review to look at what component is being done right now. Does it make sense to take advantage of more of that or less, depending on how much the market can compete with us? But so for example, we outsourced oil changes on light vehicles because it was more effective for them to do it. So we spend contracting out about $7 million a year on a $77 million budget. But not all of that is for vehicle maintenance. Some of that is for snow call-ups. And so we do have a percentage out there. The exact percentage, I'm not sure, but we're very much aware of it, and we're watching that as part of our fleet review this year.
Okay, just coming back to the private vendors in terms of servicing our vehicles, give me one example where you would send a vehicle out for servicing to somebody versus in-house servicing. And is it because of parts, lack of parts, or is it because the service requires that much more expertise? What is it?
Typically, lack of parts is interesting. So when we had some problems with parts, I'm not sure it forced us to do too much outsourcing in all fairness. But what we would typically do is for warranty work or for load. So if we just can't handle load internally, we have vendors across the city who are waiting to pick up the slack for us. Yeah, and specialty items like the compactor at the landfill, that it requires a certain expertise that it wouldn't be worth our investment to have mechanics get all that training for two units sitting out at a remote site.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Mr. Chair. Thank you, Councillor. Councillor Drews.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I do have a few concerns, and one of them is related to the question that Councillor Deans asked. I know, do we have an inventory we have to buy back? Do we have the expertise enough in our with our team right now to making sure when we have this takeover, making sure we're not getting stock that it's not belong to us and stock has been sitting, or there is any mechanism at this point that we're not getting more stuff from Napa, so we're not going to be end up on the hook for the $4.5 million?
Through you, Chair. Yeah, absolutely. The good news is we have some very professional staff who've been in the parts business for years. We're also managing the non-automotive parts for the entire city. So we've always been in the business. And if anything, and I know legal's here, I don't want to say too much about the Napa contract, but we definitely oversee what they do, and we're definitely driving the push to make sure obsolete stock moves or that they pay for it if it doesn't.
Thank you. My other question will be, like right now we're running, it's Napa already run in our facilities. We got the parts and we have our staff. Are we going to keep the same model that we have right now, just change from them to us? And we're going to keep parts in all the garages that we have right now?
Essentially, yes, except now we'll have the responsibility for the full management of the part. And as Kevin mentioned, we'll have our own. We already have our system. We're already using our system, so we already know it works, and it's already in place.
Thank you. One more question. Also, Kevin mentioned that we are having, and we're having challenge right now with holdup because we're not getting the proper parts, and we have so many emergency vehicles and things like that flooding the garage, and we're not be able to put them back on the road in a timely fashion. And as you know, we have 5 months left for that contract. And if somebody, if a vendor knows that he's losing a contract, so we already have a challenge with the service, and do we have assurance or we have a plan B? Are we going to burn all our budget from now till July so we'll be able to take over and have that soft transition? Are we prepared for that? And I just want to make sure that we have that due diligence, if you can a little bit explain a little bit that to us, the process.
Chair, we're already in those negotiations with Napa, and I can say that they're going very, very well. And I think one of the reasons they're going quite well is that Napa is not interested in continuing this arrangement either.
Thank you. And I did myself visit the garages, and Don took me on a tour. I encourage all my council colleagues to go out. I'm really happy to see that the process is coming back, and I hope we learn something from the past, because I know the system was in-house before, and we learn our lesson. I hope we can learn from this process, and moving forward, we run more efficient. Thank you very much for being here.
Councillor Kakish.
Thank you. I just want to pick up on that and on the operations perspective, because I'm not very familiar with it. We're talking about 4,500 vehicles, 265,000 parts. So how do we, with the additional five FTEs, do we rotate those people, or do we have locations set up where mechanics go there and rotate between different sites? Can you explain the operations just a bit?
So you're correct. We do have satellites, and we already have people. As part of the existing contract, we had to have those people at those satellites in any event. So we're going to continue with that same model. It's just our main facility in particular now. We'll take over all the responsibility, because currently Napa, we share the floor with Napa. So tomorrow, as Kevin mentioned, they just come to the door, right to the dock. We have the handshake right there with whoever it is, Napa or someone else, sign off that we agree to receive what we received. And then we take it from there. And we never have to worry about shrinkage that wasn't our own responsibility or anything else.
So would the mechanics be going, say, to one site to work on certain fleet for a week, and then they'd be rotating to other sites? Is that what they usually do now, and is that what they would do in the new model, or would that change?
Sorry, yeah, well, the satellites, and we have actual mechanics and parts people at the satellites. So that's already in place today. That'll continue tomorrow. So the mechanics stay at their site, and they have their parts at their site.
Okay, so they don't move around where there's different fleets in the different parts of the city. Those mechanics don't move around. The fleet always comes to them.
Parts would always come to them, correct.
Okay, so they won't be moving around the city, the five, the fleet always goes to the mechanics?
Correct.
Okay. Can we get a list of some of those facilities that we have where the main work takes place? I'd be interested to know some of that information. Okay, thank you.
Any other questions? Okay, thank you very much. Carried on the item?
Carried.
Okay, thank you. Next item is Bradley Estates Community Association's Renault Road Proposal Staff Review. We held this because we have a public delegation. Mr. Rulo, would you like to come on down? Good morning, Mr. Rule. I understand you're here on behalf of Neighborhood Watch, correct?
One other thing is that I'm putting in place a Neighborhood Watch in Bradley Estates right now, yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. You have 5 minutes. Thank you very much.
Mr. Chair, Councillor Middick, councillors and members of the committee, thank you for allowing us to the opportunity to speak this morning. My name is Denis Rouleau, and I'm one of the directors on the Bradley Estate Community Association Board. I could spend the next 5 minutes speaking to you about the numbers, the 10,000 vehicles that use Renault Road on a daily basis, or the 700 vehicles each hour during peak hours, or most importantly, the 75% of the vehicles that use Renault Road to get to the south of the city. We all have these numbers as data, so I will share with you the impact that these numbers have on our neighborhood. Traffic in our community is a very serious issue that continues to dominate our AGMs and all of our community forums. We've worked closely over the years with our city councilors, both past and present, to install a wide variety of traffic calming measures in our community. Exponential lines, painted medians, children at play signs, and flex signs, just to name a few. However, these measures just cannot keep up with a steady and steep increase in traffic volume that we are seeing. In fact, once only a problem on Renault Road, it is now seeping into the heart of our community as morning commuters wanting to go west from east and south are now choosing to bypass the long lineups on the Renault Road, and they're actually going into our community streets in order to join later on, avoiding the lineups. Because of this, Bradley Estate Community Association decided to look at the root of the problem. Renault Road has become one of the most important commuter corridors in Orleans for east-south traffic. These band-aid traffic calming measures will continue to have little to no effect. The side effect of this increase in volume is the impact it is having on our daily lives in the neighborhood. Declining quality of life due to increased noise, increased pollution, and most importantly, a decline in safety. Renault Road cuts our community in half, basically 60% to the south of Renault Road and 40% to the north of Renault Road. And we have amenities on one side that are very difficult to access by our community. Kids and youth who would like to go and play in the park or play hockey in our rink have to cross Renault Road, and it is very, very difficult. It is a road with currently one elementary school and high school to open in the fall, to which parents feel very unsafe allowing their children to walk or bike to. The spikes in volume can easily be attributed to three events: the opening of the Brian Colbert Boulevard between Tinte Line and Merbleu, which quickly funneled more traffic down the Renault Road; the 174 sinkhole that we all remember, during which time the city recommended Renault as an alternate route, even providing a police officer to direct traffic at our neighborhood intersection. Well, that police officer eventually left, but the traffic, along with the dangerous side effects, remain, and people took notice that it was an alternative route. And finally, the Anderson Road roundabout, which has been extremely effective at optimizing traffic flow at the once very problematic intersection, but having the reverse effect on traffic in our neighborhood, attracting even more commuters, more aggression, more road rage, more noise, and so forth. The Hunt Club Exchange on the 417 also showed an increase in traffic, making it very convenient for Orleans commuters to get to the south of the city, and there's more and more people wanting to go in that direction. It is easy to foresee future irreversible spikes in volume, the next leg of the Brian Coben extension to Navin Road, and the continuous construction of thousands of homes to the east of where we are in Bradley Estates. Renner Road is an extremely important east-south commuter corridor. Even Councillor Blais correctly pointed out there that Renner Road serves as a major artery for Orleans residents traveling west and south who choose to avoid the rush hour gridlock on Innes or the Queensway, and he's absolutely correct. Many homeowners relied on RCDP to ease their fears of the ever-increasing volume in traffic. It states in the CDP that it aims to reduce cut-through traffic in the Green Belt along Renner Road and reduce the number of Mud Creek crossings. The future Blackburn Hamlet bypass extension is meant to achieve this, but it is obvious to anyone who has access to the traffic counts and understand the traffic patterns that since 75% of the traffic is going south at Anderson, that will not do anything at all to the volume of traffic. Thus, our community will continue to look at these degrading effects and the high volume of commuter traffic. The realignment of Renner Road as proposed to connect with Anderson Road meets the obvious needs of Orleans commuters for an east-south corridor as well as east-west corridor, which are currently being met by a road with dangerous two 90-degree curves and passes through a bustling neighborhood, ours, with parks and school and kids. It would allow our neighborhood to become more livable, increase the quality of life for our children and our neighbors, and it would certainly be agreeable to PNCC, who have already expressed support.
5.5 minutes, if you could wrap up.
Thank you. So we basically ask that this plan be considered seriously, and not only consider the numbers that have been given there, but also the impact on the community. It is an opportunity to solve a problem that is currently starting, but will be big in the future. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you. I think there's some questions from some of the committee members. Councillor Blais.
Yes, thank you very much. Thank you for coming out this morning. I understand when you say the last phase of the Brian Coben out to Mayor Blue, how that would have led to more traffic on Renault Road as they head south and then west into the city. I don't understand, though, why the next stage, the extension to Navin, will make that worse, because those wanting to go west will continue on Brian Coben out to Navin, as opposed to going south and then west again on Renault, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So why we'll be taking traffic away from the two schools, basically, which you indicated, which you highlighted as a problem. So why is that a bad thing?
Simply because 75% of the traffic is going south. So those people will not be going north on the bypass and then coming back.
Fair enough. But if it takes them out from in front of the two schools, that at least solves part of the problem, right?
Those who are coming through Renault right now, coming from way east in Orleans and all that, they will see very little benefit for them to go north on that bypass and then returning, backtracking to go back to the nice roundabout that we have now at Anderson Road, and then going south. This is where the growth is going right now.
Yeah.
This is why these people will still want to go that way.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you.
I believe Councillor Medic has a couple of questions.
Thanks, Chair. Thanks for being here today. Denny, I know Yasmin wanted to come, but she's got sick kids and deployed husbands and all that stuff. So I just want to say I'm very supportive of building this road, because I believe it will help the community very much in achieving its quality of life stuff, and also helping with East End traffic in the future. But my question was, elaborate a little bit on the livability of the neighborhood. Like, you mentioned quality of life, how it splits the neighborhood, and what's the environmental like impact of this to you guys as far as your quality of life?
Like I mentioned there, Bradley Estates, if you take Renault, 60% of residents live south of Renault and 40% live north. We have beautiful parks on the north end side. Our hockey rink is there right now. And for the kids basically to go and play in those parks, they have to cross Renault. Right now, the parents basically will not let them go. They will not let them walk there. They will not let them bike to those parks because the very heavy volume that we have on Renault and that one intersection there that you have to take your life in your hands when you want to cross there at Joshua and Renault. Parents will not do that. It was mentioned there that we have a school, elementary school right now on Renault. Nobody walks to that school. Nobody bikes to that school. Everybody is either bused or driven to that school for the same reason. And if you stay outside during the day and listen to the traffic on the Renault Road, in fact, some traffic data was gathered on this saying over a 24-hour period, the average speed on the 50-kilometer road was 74, and it was clocked as high as 130 because it is a straight stretch that we have there. So the volume of traffic will continue to be that. It's noise, it's pollution, but it is most importantly safety for our kids and people who want to use the park that we have there. We have a beautiful trail, Prescott Russell's trail there. Unfortunately, the trail is crossed twice by Renault Road, and believe me, you do not cross that Renault Road coming on the trail without getting off your bike and making sure that the traffic is going through. And it happens twice. At the end, right in those two 90-degree turn, this is where we have the very dangerous place for people using the trail. And believe me, there's a lot of people using that trail, both in the winter and especially in the summer with their bikes, their dogs, and it's used extensively.
Yeah. So from a scale of 1 to 10, on a community perspective, this is a 10?
Absolutely.
Any other questions for the delegation? Thank you very much for coming down. Appreciate it. Report received? Received, thank you. Next held item was number 5, Ottawa Road 174, Prescott Russell Road 17, environmental assessment study recommendations. We held this because we have a public delegation, Nancy Biggs. Is Ms. Biggs here? No, she's coming down. Do you have a question? Oh, you're back. Okay. Still okay. I think he steps out there. Good morning, Ms. Biggs. Welcome. You have 5 minutes to present.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you for allowing me to speak to you today. I'd like to comment on the environmental assessment of the widening of Highway 174 from Trim Road to Cannon Road.
Sorry, I'm just going to interrupt for you a second. I could ask committee members to take their chairs so we can all see the delegation and presentation, please.
Okay. Yeah. So there's going to be adding 2 high occupancy vehicle lanes to the Highway 174. Oops. I don't have to go back. The report is a very thorough and detailed study looking at 4 alternate corridors to accommodate the projected peak hour traffic in 2031. 2 high occupancy vehicle lanes will be added to meet demand. However, I believe there's a missing piece of analysis in the report's environmental impact section, which made no mention of the resulting greenhouse gas emissions for the added number of cars driving into the city. I believe all projects need to take into account greenhouse gas reduction targets set in the Air Quality and Climate Change Management Plan. Environment Canada projects that greenhouse gas emissions with the current measures will result in missing the Canadian target by 55%, showing more needs to be done. Ontario has a goal to reduce greenhouse gas emissions to 15% below 1990 emissions by 2020 and 80% by 2050. This graph illustrates projected emissions with and without policy measures and the remaining gap to reach the 2050 target. So far in Ottawa, under the 2014 Air Quality and Climate Change Management Plan, the per capita goal is a reduction in greenhouse gases of 20% from 2012 to 2024. However, when you include population growth, the absolute reduction will only be 12%. In 2005, a destination survey of the National Capital Region was done. It's very detailed, showing population, occupation, transit use, number of cars per household, daily trips, travel patterns, giving the top five destinations, purpose of the trip and primary travel mode. The main takeaway points I got from the study was there are local jobs for one in three rural employees and the rest commute to suburban urban jobs. Only one in 20 rural travelers have transit passes and don't seem to be using the park and ride. The city has projected rapid growth in both Orleans and Rockland. Using the American EPA's formula for annual passenger vehicle emissions, I estimated that 1,000 more cars commuting from Rockland to Orleans will create 4,400 metric tons of carbon dioxide each year. Urban sprawl comes at a cost, and we should be aware of the added greenhouse gas emissions from commuters traveling to the core. It will be impossible to meet our greenhouse gas emission targets pursuing business as usual. Business as usual approach of building more and more roads to the outer reaches of the city which only encourages urban sprawl. I suggest the Transportation Committee consider requesting a further analysis be done in the environmental assessment study to include greenhouse gas emissions, given its term of council priority, strategic objective and initiative ES1. Everyone wants less congestion, but is what we are doing enough? More and wider roads help accommodate more drivers, but they only relieve congestion temporarily. Canada's Eco-Fiscal Commission think congestion pricing is the missing piece of the puzzle. Road use is free, but traffic is expensive. Pricing congestion creates better incentives and smarter choices. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much. I believe Councillor Blay has a question for you.
Thanks very much for coming out this morning. I gather by your presentation then efforts that the city or other governments could make to encourage public transit use would be high on your list of projects that are worth investing in.
That's correct.
And so if the additional lane on 174 was dedicated either during rush hour or all the time to carpool and transit lanes so that Clarence Rockland could provide an effective transit service to their residents, that would be a good thing in your mind.
Yes, and in fact, the study recommends that the two lanes are high occupancy vehicle lanes. I guess my concern is, do people then go to a park and ride and then come into the city there?
Sure, that is a perfectly fair point. At present, if you're a Clarence Rockland resident, the bus passes upwards of $280, and you're stuck in a single lane on a bus in gridlock traffic. So the incentives to use transit are not very high. It's slow, and it's exceedingly expensive. As we extend light rail to Orleans and possibly even to Trim, and if we provide a free-flowing transit lane for these buses to operate in, you can ping-pong back and forth very quickly, reducing your costs, improving transit, and then reducing greenhouse gas emissions and reducing congestion on the Ottawa Highway.
Yes.
Is that something you would agree with?
I agree with that. It's just whether people, I think one of this 2005 study showed only one in 20 of the people in the rural area were purchasing transit passes. I'm meaning that they would drive to a park and ride and then from the take a OC Transpo into the city. The hopes would be that with the LRT would go to Trim Road and people would leave their car at the park and ride. It's just that my main point was more about the environmental assessment of a study did not include greenhouse gas emissions, and that we still have to have that sustainability lens when looking at all projects.
Yeah, I think that's a fair point. I think both the recommendations of the report, and certainly as the councillor for the area and in speaking with the other councillors that are impacted by this, I think we're all right in the same box here, and in terms of how to make this work and why we're really doing this. So thank you very much for your presentation.
You're welcome.
Thank you, and don't go away yet. Councillor Chernyshenko has a question for you.
Actually, I realize it's perhaps more a thanks than a question. I do, for colleagues who might not have had time to look at Ms. Biggs' presentation, I'm a little bit funny that way. I made time for this one. It's a particular interest of mine, and my item coming shortly ties into the possible study of congestion pricing. I thank you for a lot of useful information to feed into all of our decisions on our transportation networks and some recent studies on pricing, what is and isn't working in various venues, so I thank you for bringing that to our attention. I know you had nowhere near enough time to present that here today. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Are there any other questions for the delegation? Thank you for coming down this morning. It's appreciated. Before we get to the vote, there's a technical amendment to the report that I'm going to ask Vice Chair McKinney to introduce.
Thank you, Chair. You want me to read out the whole thing? Do I have to? Okay. Well, not the back, no, just the whereas. Whereas the report entitled Ottawa Road 174 Prescott Russell Road 17 Trim Road to Cannon Road Environmental Assessment Study Recommendations was distributed with the Transportation Committee agenda, and whereas the report did not contain comments under the asset management implications section, and whereas there are asset management implications associated with the recommendations in the report, and whereas this omission should be corrected before the report rises to council, therefore be it resolved that Transportation Committee approve the revised page 36 to the report attached herein as document 1, which reflects the asset management implications, and replace it in the report to council.
Can we carry that motion? And I think Councillor Chernyshenko has a question for staff. Carry the motion?
Carry.
Okay, Councillor Chernyshenko, question for staff.
I guess I have a question to staff on the whole report and stemming from the point that Ms. Biggs made. To what degree does an environmental assessment, the mandated process, take into account greenhouse gas emission reductions, increases, and maybe I'll ask you to answer that, then I'll do my follow-up.
Chair, in every environmental assessment study, there is an analysis of air quality. Particulate matter, nitrogen dioxide, and carbon monoxide, those are all assessed, and those are the things that come out of vehicle exhausts. And this study shows that even with the widening, we are still within the acceptable limits recognized by the province. GHG itself is not a component of the EA, because should be dealt with on a broader area rather than just individual projects, because it ties into major transportation as well as land use. So if we have sprawl and people have to travel more kilometers in their car, so that is the part of the equation for GHG. So it's more difficult to do it at a single project level.
Mm-hmm. Interesting. I guess the growing societal recognition, and obviously council's recognition with our recent passing of new targets and higher goals, that knowing our emissions and opportunities to reduce them and definitely not increase them, where would you say is the best place to insert that? Perhaps new lens, perhaps new mandatory reporting, so that we have that information when we make a decision?
That would tie into our master plans and our official plans, so they deal with how the city develops and where it develops. We can certainly do that analysis with the TMP, with our trans model, looking at the different types of land uses or the road network and what the impact would be. So for future, to address future needs, then we look at how do we minimize that, through what types of transportation facilities do we build. More transit, less, fewer roads, more active transportation corridors, those kinds of things will help. So it's a much broader picture for the whole city.
Mm-hmm. I would say particularly in the light of the fairly hot, fresh off the press, provincial, the cap and trade announcements, the possibility of access to funding through the carbon credits of certain projects, and perhaps absolutely not access to that funding for other projects. I think it's important that we, if we're not thinking already that way, that we look to where we would automatically measure and report on that, so that we are able to make those judgments. So whether it's now or later, I guess, would welcome knowing how staff are anticipating inserting that into all of our master planning.
Yes, we will make that as part of our review. So to take it to a project level in terms of funding, applications for funding, there are mechanisms that we can put into place, conversion of vehicles and their emissions. We can do that.
That's good to hear, because my sense, quite a strong sense, the signals are both provincially and federally that there will be a very green tinge to and greenhouse gas reduction tinge to infrastructure funding coming forward. We don't know the specifics yet, but to be able to make a, for Ottawa to be able to make a case that certain projects qualify, I think would be very helpful. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other questions for staff? Okay, report carried as amended. Carried. Thank you. Back onto the agenda then. We had no in-camera items. Information is as previously distributed to committee members, though for item C, Councillor Chernyshenko would like to lift the studying the best practices of road pricing and requires two-thirds in order to do that. So do we allow him to do that? To lift, yes.
If we lose these two, we can lose one.
On that?
We're still okay? Jeff? If those both, Matt's leading too. Okay.
We do have two-thirds. Apparently there's a baseball announcement. So as long as nobody else leaves the room, we can deal with your matter.
All right.
Someone wants to kill it, I guess they can just
walk
out of the room.
May or may not be a good thing, depending on who left, right?
You have a motion to introduce, as I understand it.
Yes, please. I think this is simpler than it looks. I won't read the whole motion, but essentially I'll tell you what I'm trying to do and what I'm not trying to do. I am not trying to get on the floor right now council to agree to fund a study of congestion pricing and road tolls, etc. What this motion does is ask that staff include in their planning for the next transportation master plan a study that would essentially inform either this council or a future council of what the best practices are in congestion pricing, what's working in other cities, what isn't, what Ottawa might want to consider, and because I think that would be a useful input to future master planning. So I'm essentially at this point, it's a fairly open request that staff come back at a future budget year with a proposal for a study and the costs associated with that, and we at that point would debate, we would know the proposed cost and we would debate actually adopting that. So perhaps this is an advance notice more than anything. And I did, apologies, I'm going to blame the storm. I was going to send you all a memo describing that and giving you a motion in advance. That didn't happen. You got the motion about 5 minutes ago on your desk.
Councillor Cawdrey has a question for staff, I believe.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chair. Just a question from staff. Would you have already not included that kind of information in the report that may be coming forward?
We do some preliminary work like that in the past, but this is more of a detailed view, so it would be incorporated into our work if this motion gets passed.
So, Ms. Chi, thank you for that. So you're basically saying that if this motion carries or gets passed, that the report from staff will have more detail on this particular topic than normally that would have been included?
The study would be more detailed than what we've done in the past, and it would roll into the TMP work.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Councillor Deans, please.
Oh, you know, I'm kind of two minds of this motion because on one hand, I
can help actually clarify for a second here, as the clerk pointed out, and Councillor Chernyshenko just clarified, he's not asking this as a notice of motion to be dealt with later. He wants it dealt with today, so we actually have to vote on that as well.
Right.
So, are we all okay with the motion proceeding today? If we're not, then you don't need to ask any questions because it's not happening today.
We already agreed to that. Didn't
no, we agreed to lift the item.
Oh.
We're now voting on whether this motion can proceed today without. Is everybody okay with that?
I introduced the motion earlier than I should have. We had not yet requested or received that. Okay.
It's not a notice of motion?
No. So what we voted on was we voted to lift the IPD. But Councillor Chernyshenko wants to deal with the motion, wants to deal with it today. So not to give us notice for next meeting, but today, so we also have to vote on waiving the rules to allow his motion to be dealt with today.
Okay. If everybody's I personally am of two minds of this motion, so maybe a little more time to contemplate it wouldn't be a bad thing for me. But normally when we waive the rules to address an issue, it's because it's a time-sensitive issue. So I guess I'd just like to hear from the mover of the motion, what is the time sensitivity around this issue?
Fair question.
Which I'm glad to address. There is not a time sensitivity. It was simply because we were receiving the report that this was the opportunity to lift it, and it seemed the best time to move the motion. I had not thought of it, but I'd be just as comfortable with it being a notice of motion and that we properly debate it at a future meeting.
Yeah. So everybody's more comfortable with that? Okay. Just warning you, the next meeting's already long, so it's going to be longer
so
again.
You don't have to debate my notice of motion. This is my notice of motion.
That
if we can on the fly check that box and remove the other one, I'd be glad to do that.
Okay.
Okay.
All right. So that's what we'll do then. Okay. Are there any notice of motions? Well, we now have one for consideration of a subsequent meeting that we didn't have before.
I have a motion. I want to walk on to this agenda.
Yeah, other business. We'll get there in 1 second.
Okay.
Are there any other notices of motion in addition to Councillor Chernyshenko's for being dealt with at a later meeting? No. So Councillor Deans would like to, under other business, would like to walk on a motion today. So I'm going to ask her the same question that she asked Councillor Chernyshenko with the urgency.
Yeah, and
yes.
I am prepared to address that. Basically, the motion is around signage for the Children's Hospital of Eastern Ontario YouthNet program. And the urgency is the program is already up and running, and there are already some confusion being experienced with the location of it. So they need this signage. If we waited until the next meeting, April 6, with the time it takes to prepare everything, it would be well into May before they could get the signage, and it's a problem. So they've asked to have it walked onto this agenda.
Is everybody okay with that? Perhaps you could indicate what the signage, yes.
Yeah, this is the signage. It's basically just a wayfinding signage to direct people to the CHEO YouthNet program.
So are we okay with adding that onto the agenda today? Okay.
Okay, it's a big long motion. Do you want me to read it? I guess I should. Whereas the Children's Hospital of Eastern Ontario, which is a vital community partner providing health care services to children and youth, operates a YouthNet program at 2305 Saint Laurent Boulevard that is designed to promote balanced mental health and reduce stigma surrounding mental issues for youth. And whereas many of the youth who attend the program arrive using public transportation. And whereas CHEO has identified a need for a sign directing the participants of the CHEO YouthNet program to their facility at 2305 Saint Laurent Boulevard based on feedback given by participants in the layout of the Ottawa Business Park. Whereas the sign in question will be located on the city's right-of-way and the sign on City Roads Bylaw number 2003-520 section 4 does not authorize such signs. And whereas council in the past has approved non-permitted signs such as farm directional signs whose vertical signs are similar in design to the proposed CHEO YouthNet sign. And whereas it is desirable to allow the sign to be installed within the city's highway at 2305 Saint Laurent Boulevard to allow for adequate identification. And whereas staff have voiced no objections to the proposed design of the CHEO YouthNet sign nor the proposed fees, both of which are in line with the farm signage program. And whereas CHEO YouthNet has agreed to bear the cost of $810 for the fabrication and installation of the wayfinding signage and have agreed to a fee of $75, which is to be paid every 5 years. Therefore, be it resolved that committee waive the application of Section 4 of the bylaw to allow CHEO's YouthNet sign to be located at the entrance of the 2305 Saint Laurent Boulevard, provided that A, CHEO YouthNet enter into an agreement that all the costs for the fabrication, installation, ongoing maintenance, and eventual removal be borne by CHEO, and B, CHEO YouthNet enter into agreement that a fee of $75 is to be paid every 5 years to the city to allow the sign to remain within the city's highway, and two, staff be directed to fabricate and install the agreed upon signage template at CHEO's YouthNet facility. So, Mr. Chair, CHEO approached us because they were having some problems with identifying this location within the Ottawa Business Park. They originally asked for their own logo, and the city frowns upon that now. They want to use a standardized city, one that looks more like this. So the compromise that we worked out was to put the CHEO brand in yellow on the city sign. So that's basically it. I did receive an email from...
I don't think there's an issue, Councillor. I'm looking around the table. Does anybody have any concern with this motion? No, so I think...
Okay, well, just one other thing, Councillor Munter. The CEO of CHEO, who, by the way, earned a great honour this week in terms of being one of the best employers in Canada, did send a message basically saying this. There's still lots of stigma around mental illness, and it can be really tough for a team with depression or anxiety to screw up the courage and walk into a mental health program. Having clear, welcoming signage, making YouthNet easy to find is a small but tangible way the city can be part of our collective response to these youth. So thank you very much for your support. I appreciate it.
I think that's carried. Carried? Any other business? Adjournment? Okay. Next meeting is April the 6th, 2016. And again, it promises to be a lengthy one and even longer now with Councillor Chernyshenko's assistance, but that's okay. We'll see you all then. Hopefully it will not be snowing that day, or raining, or freezing rain, or freezing drizzle, or any of those options. It will just be nice and bright and sunny.